So the results from the quantitative findings were actually really interesting because they identified 10 factors that help explain why a defendant is wrongly convicted as opposed to a near miss. And I just want to make sure that we get this down correctly. So these 10 factors are, number one, the age of the defendant. Number two, the defendant's criminal history. Number three, the strength of the prosecution's case. Number four, the quality of the defense that the defendant had. Number five, whether the defense brings or puts on a family witness. Number six, whether the prosecution fails to turn over exculpatory evidence. Number seven, whether this prosecution takes place in a state with a punitive culture on the death penalty. Number eight, whether there is lying by a non-eyewitness. Number nine, whether a misidentification that happens in this case is an honest misidentification. And then number 10, whether the forensic evidence that is offered is presented accurately or not. What we found was that having any criminal history made a defendant more likely to be wrongly convicted. So simply being known to police or prosecutors, having any prior familiarity with the criminal justice system, put someone at greater risk for a wrongful conviction. So let's take a moment here and let me explain how we used our expert panel to help us understand this. Because we have this quantitative finding, we have this finding from one half of the research that says criminal history is related to wrongful conviction, but not criminal history of this crime for which the person's being indicted for. So we brought the expert panel together. And what they helped us to understand is that what might be going on here is simply being known to police officers means that someone's name comes up in an officer's mind as a potential suspect, or someone's picture is then in a mugshot book. And if someone's picture is in a mugshot book, it means that they are potentially at greater risk of being incorrectly picked out of that photo book by the victim or some eyewitness to the crime. So simply being known to police officers or having any prior photo of a defendant potentially makes him at greater risk of being wrongly convicted. Let me say a little bit more about another one of the variables, and that is this forensic evidence variable. So prior research has shown that errors in forensic evidence explain wrongful convictions. Instead, what our research shows is improper testimony about the forensic evidence is what ends up leading to a wrongful conviction. So we've talked about the 10 variables that are related to the wrongful convictions and the near misses, and we talked about the expert panel. So someone might naturally ask, well, is this credible? And I think these are highly credible results. These are results that I feel very confident about. So that begs the question, well, why? Why do you feel so confident about what you found? And there are really two answers to that. The first one is we did a statistical test that we call an ROC curve. Now that's highly technical. I don't expect anyone to really be interested in that other than a few statisticians. But what that showed is that we have tremendous certainty in the results we found, that these 10 variables are statistically related to the outcome that we were looking for. The other piece of this that makes me confident is that we had the expert panel to double check these results and to see whether they make sense in their practice in the criminal justice system. And not only did they tell us that these results made sense, but they were able to help us understand how they operate. So I think these are highly credible results.